This original WSRE presentation is made possible by viewers like you. Thank you. Imagine a place in Florida, untouched. Welcome to Pensacola, thriving, culturally rich. Celebrating over 450 years of history as one of America's first settlements, Pensacola's unhurried pace soothes your senses with art galleries, world-class museums, festivals, air shows, great local flavors, and more, all linked by miles of sugar-white beaches. Pensacola, an experience you'll never forget. Additional support for this program comes from the Santa Rosa Island Authority, located in beautiful Pensacola Beach, Florida. Offering a variety of entertainment, shopping, recreational, and dining venues. Pensacola Beach, adjacent to Gulf Island's National Seashore, just waiting for you and your family to explore.
Sparkling waters, pristine, untouched beaches, barrier islands, salt marshes, bayous, forests of live oaks, pines, and magnolias, historic structures, winding nature trails, and a diverse array of wildlife. This is Gulf Island's National Seashore, the treasure of the Gulf Coast. Stretching 160 miles from the western coast of the Florida Panhandle to the islands in Mississippi, Gulf Islands is rich in history, culture, and natural beauty.
Gulf Islands is kind of a piece of America in that it's a natural treasure of barrier islands, both in Florida and Mississippi. It's also the man-made environment that reflects the early part of American history, seacoast defense with Fort Pickens, Fort Barranca. It's naval live oaks with a great hardwoods that they built the ships, including the USS Constitution, known as Old Ironside. To me, it's the seashore is just a little bit of American history and a great deal of American nature woven into one.
From the time of early colonization to the Civil War to the present day, the history of America begins in Gulf Island's National Seashore. Within the last five centuries, the region has been host to Native Americans, Spanish colonists, French troops, enslaved Africans, British and American settlers, Confederate armies, and the U.S. Navy and Army. Archaeologists have discovered evidence of Indian villages on the beaches, tracing back the existence of human life on these shores for thousands of years. The Pensacola Indians lived along the coast of Florida, using nearby forests to hunt and gather food. In 1559, Spanish explorer Don Tristan de Luna sailed his ship into Pensacola Bay. He claimed the land he found in the name of Spain, and Pensacola became the first European settlement in the United States. Plagued by illness and fierce weather, the colony established by de Luna did not survive. In the century that followed, the Spanish sent nearly a dozen exploratory missions to the Gulf Coast area, eventually establishing a settlement in 1698 near the area now known as Barrancas. Spanish settlers in the 1700s built batteries on land, defending themselves against attacks from Europeans. In the 1790s, the Spanish added a masonry water battery, which stands today.
This is the only Spanish colonial fortification of its kind. It was built by the Spanish during their last occupation of Pensacola from 1781 to 1821. Now, what's unique about this water battery, Batería de San Antonio, is it was designed to skip cannonballs off of the water to hit ships coming into the bay.
During this century, at different times, both the French and the British captured and maintained control of the area. Eventually, the Spanish regained command of the region, but officially surrendered the land to the United States in 1821, ending nearly 240 years of Spanish reign. The area's strategic location to the Gulf of Mexico made it crucial in defense of the mainland. And beginning in 1829, the United States built 5 brick forts as part of the nation's third system coastal defense, designed to prevent attacks from foreign countries. Fort Pickens is the largest of the forts of Gulf Islands. Construction on the fort began in 1829 and was completed in 1834. Located at the western tip of Santa Rosa Island, Fort Pickens guarded the island as well as the entrance to the Pensacola Harbor. The fort saw action during the Civil War and was also used as a fortification during the First and Second World Wars.
Gulf Islands National Seashore, what you're going to see out there, I believe, is one of the biggest fort you'll ever see in your lifetime. It's, if not the third, the fourth largest fort in the country. And it just has this ambiance about it. When you walk through it, you imagine the floors, how sometimes when they're uneven. You're walking really where soldiers have walked since the 1800s. You're walking through hallways that Geronimo and the Chiricahua Apaches, the chiefs, you know, walk through. Their children. You're walking through the hallways and imagining conversations going on between soldiers during World War I or II and training out here, missing their families and working on the guns and just companionship of them all. So it's a little different. If walls could talk, sometimes that's what I say. Go through the fort, be quiet, and just go through it and listen.
Millions of handmade bricks were laid in arched configurations to support the cannons on top, with munitions storage rooms, rifle ports, living quarters, and passageways for soldiers underneath.
When you think about the construction of this place, someone had to come out into the end of a barrier island and envision this massive fort. And then these engineers came out of West Point, trained to build this sort of thing, lay out the walls. They knew the size of the standard bricks. They knew how many millions it was going to take. They had to estimate their budgets for these things. 21.5 million bricks it took to build this fort, all of them locally made, all of them barged out to the island. Many people don't know that there was a large brick making industry in Pensacola Bay. I mean, if you look around Pensacola, it looks like it's all sand, but if you know where to look, there are large pockets of clay here and there, especially around the bay where the rivers feed into them. There was a large brick making industry. In fact, about half the bricks on Fort Jefferson down the Garden Key in the Dry Tortugas, one of the largest forts we built, half of those bricks came from Pensacola as well. But all of these bricks came from Pensacola. The Army did things much like we still do things in the government. They put out specifications, took bids. We know at least 3 different brickyards supplied bricks here. We know 3 different brickyards supplied bricks to Fort Barrancas. The brick construction explains part of the beauty of this fort, but because it's a solid brick building, you cannot build it with flat ceilings. You can't build a flat brick ceiling. It won't hold its own weight, and you've got to remember that on top of these arches was about 10 feet of sand, and then cannons on top of those, which weighed between 2 and 3 tons apiece. So there's a huge amount of weight bearing down on this building, but an arch distributes weight along its length, which makes it very, very stable. I mean, there are arches the Romans built thousands of years ago that are still standing in places, and these are pretty sturdy arches.
African-American slaves labored to construct the forts, each containing impressive architecture and symmetrical arches with massive walls many feet thick. The slaves worked for years to complete the forts, hand-cutting each of the millions of bricks to fit into intricate patterns.
Unfortunately, we don't know very much about the slaves who were used in building the fort. We have some idea of the numbers of them. There were one time as many as 200 slaves working on Fort Pickens, for instance. The workforce at Fort Barrancas apparently was never larger than 60 men, and this included masons, carpenters, and laborers. Some brought from New Orleans, and some hired locally. Everything they got out here, they brought out by boat. There was no road into the Fort Pickens area until the 1950s. And so the Army had docks. Each of the outlying gun batteries has got the remains of a dock nearby. Once they got things onto the island from the very early period, from the 1820s, they laid railroad tracks out. They had carts for the supplies. The carts were pulled by mules mostly. In a later period, the Army actually had a train track set up with small engines that ran back and forth for like the last 2 miles out here. Coast Artillery guys called it the B&F Railroad for back and forth, because that's all it went back and forth to Langdon and down here.
Fort Pickens was an important Union post during the Civil War, used to defend the mainland and attack the Confederates. The Confederates left Pensacola in 1862, but Fort Pickens continued to be used to house prisoners, including Confederate soldiers and Indians. Among the most famous of these prisoners was Geronimo, leader of the Apache Nation.
It was one of the last major parts of the Indian Wars. When Geronimo actually surrendered in 1886, the Army had been trying to keep the Apaches on reservations. They put them in a fairly awful place, but Geronimo kept leaving, and every time he'd leave, he'd kill people, and they stole cattle and things of that nature. The last time he left, they had about half of the Mexican Army and a quarter of the U.S. Army hunting him down, and they only finally got to him because the U.S. Army hired Apache scouts. A lot of the Apaches were really tired of Geronimo causing him trouble. It was part of Geronimo's surrender, the Army guaranteed that he would not be hanged. Partly to control the Chiricahuas and partly to protect them, the Army shipped them out of Arizona to someplace far away from anything they had ever seen, which was Florida. Now, much like I-10 runs across the southern part of the country today, there were railroad tracks running across them, and they were headed for St. Augustine. And seven prominent businessmen put together a petition to their congressman asking the War Department, as it was called then, to leave Geronimo at Fort Pickens because this fort was famous as a Union bastion during the Civil War. It's one of our larger forts. What better place to put him than this famous American fort? And the thinking amongst the Pensacolians was that, oh, by the way, people would probably want to come see him because he was famous and he hadn't killed anybody in this part of the country, and those people would need places to stay and food to eat while they were here, so it was kind of the beginning of our tourist boom, really.
Fort McRae was built opposite Fort Pickens on Perdido Key, but suffered heavy damage in combat during the Civil War.
And it was built right on the edge of the water, so it was always a little problematic. What happened to Fort McRae was mainly that on November 22nd and 23rd of 1861, it got pounded into pieces by the U.S. artillery firing from Fort Pickens and by a couple of ships of the U.S. Navy, the Richmond and Niagara, this massive Civil War bombardment. The Confederates actually had to abandon it during the first day's bombardment because fires had broken out inside, because there was a lot of wood in that structure, which was another unusual design. Well, since these forts were obsolete by the end of the Civil War, it was never repaired, and then the fort gradually washed into the water, more or less, because it was right on the edge of the surf.
Fort Barrancas was completed in 1844, built on the ruins of the Spanish Fort San Carlos de Barrancas.
This is a part of the third system of forts that were constructed immediately after the War of 1812, from 1816 to 1867. This was a part of a defensive system, a permanent seacoast defensive line from Maine all the way around the tip of Florida, all the way over to New Orleans. There are four of these types of forts built here in Pensacola. Fort Brancas is going to be the third one. Its mission was to defend the entrance to Pensacola Harbor, as well as a land-based assault across the peninsula should anybody be attacking the Navy Yard. As local lore would have it, some would believe that the first shots of the American Civil War were actually fired right here at Fort Barrancas. January 8, 1861, there was a U.S. artillery group here commanded by Lieutenant Adam Slimmer. That night, Lieutenant Slimmer had posted guards or sentries, and it's a good thing that he did, because shortly after the hours of midnight on January 8, 1861, a group of men are going to approach the fort. The sentries will challenge them. They will refuse to halt. They will make it to the drawbridge, and then the first shots are fired. Now, as local lore would have it, we're not exactly sure if the muskets were loaded, because at this time they didn't actually want to waste their ammunition, but shots were fired here, and some would say that these are the first shots of the Civil War, or the first shots to defend the Union. During the American Civil War, the Confederate held mainland and the Union held San Rosa Island actually exchanged artillery fire. For two straight days, both sides shot over 6,000 cannonballs between the two. Now, the Confederate-held Fort McRae, as well as the Navy Yard, were both heavily damaged during the artillery bombardment, but Fort Barrancas was relatively unscathed. We do have one place in the fort where you can actually see the results of that artillery fire right here to the present day. A cannonball hit the outside of the wall, and when it did, it actually shattered the bricks on the inside. It's this 4-foot thick brick right here, and you can see the resulting blast that occurred from a ball or a projectile hitting the outside of the fort.
Construction of a Navy Yard on Pensacola Bay began in 1826. Early naval vessels were built using the durable wood harvested from thick forests of live oak. In 1828, by order of President John Quincy Adams, the Navy purchased the lands and established the very first United States tree farm, preserving over 60,000 acres. The area today, known as Naval Live Oaks, is preserved as part of Gulf Island's National Seashore. Fort Barrancas, Fort Pickens, and Fort McRae worked together to establish a crossfire of artillery against any attacking fleet of ships that would attempt to reach Pensacola through the harbor. The advanced redoubt was built specifically to defend against land approaches to Fort Barrancas and the Pensacola Navy Yard.
With the water battery looking down the channel, and then the advanced redoubt behind Fort Barrancas forms a fortified line across the neck of the peninsula, which today holds the Naval Air Station. So it was a very heavily fortified little area.
The forts, which were once considered the first line of defense to the area, became obsolete as the military developed more advanced weaponry. Cannons firing heavy metal balls were replaced by more modern artillery. Wooden ships were no longer built, making it unnecessary to harvest the live oaks. In 1947, with the Second World War over, the four remaining forts were declared surplus and were no longer used as military fortresses. Nearly two decades passed while the forts were left to deteriorate with the devastation of time and weather. In the 1960s, local citizens began efforts to preserve and protect the forts and surrounding areas. Among the citizens who worked to have the area preserved as a unit of America's national parks was Earl Bowden, then editor of the local newspaper, the Pensacola Journal. Bowden is now known as the father of Gulf Islands for his dedication in working to protect and preserve the area.
I always thought that Pensacola Harbor and its our very diverse history here, colonial history, Five Flags legacy. We had landmarks here that were just as important as some of the other landmarks that are preserved in national parks. And we didn't have a national park. I was, in the beginning, very interested in making sure that Fort Pickens and Fort Barrancas were preserved, because I was, at that time, a real Civil War student, and I was very interested in that. But I thought that they're wonderful specimens of man's ingenuity toward coastal defense. Why not save them? You know, we save cannons at Gettysburg, and we say the Spanish fort at St. Augustine. Well, that was just the beginning of it. We had a long, bitter fight about the preservation of these barrier islands by townspeople who opposed it because they didn't want the federal government controlling their beaches, or we thought that was true. It turns out it was a very limited number of politicians who had that. Finally, when we had a congressional hearing in Pensacola of senators and members of House of Representatives, the room was filled with people, garden clubs, environmental groups, bass fishermen, all kind of guys, who all stood up and said, we want a national park.
In 1971, President Richard M. Nixon signed into law the bill that designated the area as the nation's largest national seashore. Magnificent beaches stretch from the Florida coast to the shores of Mississippi. The snow-white sand found on these beaches was created from quartz minerals that flowed in rivers from the Appalachian Mountains all the way to the waters of the Gulf of Mexico.
These islands are like ropes of sand, barriers wrestling with the tide, the wind and the tides, and they are ever changing. They're somewhat the same, but they're always changing. It's an ever-changing environment. And that's the beauty of it. And they are fragile. We know that. The ecosystem is extremely fragile, should be protected.
What you see behind me are sea oats, and it's one of the most important plants in the national park, whose roots extend down 20 to 30 feet, in spectacular bloom right now, coming into the fall.
Gulf Islands National Seashore is also listed as a national watchable wildlife area. The seashore's diverse habitats provide resting, feeding, and nesting areas for a variety of wildlife, some of which are endangered.
We are the largest national seashore out of all the national parks, 390 plus. We are comprised of 6 offshore, 5,000-year-old barrier, brilliant white barrier islands with the Gulf of Mexico and all of her magnificence. We have actually pods of killer whale out there. The average depth of the Gulf of Mexico is at about 5,000 feet, highly vulnerable to storms, but that's what the function of the barrier islands is, to absorb the storm shock. So through all the changes that she goes through, we may think that it's life-stopping, so to speak, but the island has no problem in continuing life as reflected in these sea oats here.
When you first come onto the island and you look down from, say, the entrance station area, it almost looks like you're heading into a big desert. You've got the Gulf of Mexico on one side and Pensacola Bay on the other, and it's hard to imagine the diversity of plants and animals that you're going to find. But we have not only a huge variety of birds, but reptiles, amphibians, mammals, marine life, both freshwater and saltwater. And it's a great place to come out and observe nature pretty much intact.
Of the 7 species of sea turtles, 4 nest at Gulf Islands, all of which are endangered. For most of the summer each year, the park's biologists and a host of volunteers locate, mark, and date the nests. 60 days after the eggs are laid, tiny turtles emerge from the sands and make their way to the waters of the Gulf of Mexico.
Visiting us would be the leatherback sea turtle, the green sea turtle, the hawksbill, and the loggerhead sea turtle. And out of those 4 species, probably the most common would be the loggerhead and the greens, and the occasional hawksbill. And the heat of the sand determines the sex of the turtles. So our sands up here produce more males, which we think that that's pretty valuable. Down south would be more females.
Hurricanes have altered parts of the beach and primary dunes so that some nests are vulnerable to flooding in high tide cycles. If the nest floods during a high tide, the turtles inside the eggs drown. To avoid this, biologists relocate approximately a fourth of the nests each year to higher ground or remove the eggs to incubate and hatch them. The hatchlings are later released at the exact site of their original nests.
We will relocate the sea turtle nest due to hazardous weather. If the tide and the storm surge gets up high enough, the park ranger sea turtle volunteers will relocate the nest within a ice chest, let them incubate within the ice chest, and then release them back after the threat of a tropical storm has passed.
These guys are just chucked in right for the gull.
From May through October, our sea turtle volunteers will ride an ATV, I think it's beginning like at 5 o'clock in the morning, go down from Navarre all the way down to Perdido Key in search of the tracks of the sea turtle that may have nested there the night before. They mark it in their own special way with their poles, or their screen it so that the predators will not get to the sea turtle nest. But that way we're able to account for the sea turtles, I believe about 40 in the national park this year.
The laughing gull is the most common bird at Gulf Islands. Sanderlings stop to feed during an 8,000-mile trip between the Arctic and South America. Migrating and nesting birds live among the sand dunes.
Here at Gulf Islands National Seashore, we try to protect the birds the best we can by putting up enclosures around the areas where the birds have nested. And the enclosures consist of poles with signs on them that say keep out and explain that it's a bird nesting area.
From bald eagles to endangered snowy plovers to the black skimmers and least terns, over 260 varieties of birds find Gulf Islands, part of the Great Florida Birding Trail, to be the perfect haven for nesting on the beaches or resting on their journeys to other parts of the world.
The least terns, they dig a divot in the sand and they lay 2 to 3 eggs, and then they sit on their eggs until they hatch, which takes about 25 days. And then the chicks hatch and they're able to walk immediately, but they cannot feed themselves. So the parents go and they catch the fish and bring them back and feed them for about another 25 days until they can fly. And then they go out and they are able to catch their own fish at that point. So it's about 2 months from the time the birds copulate, lay the eggs, and the chicks fledge. The black skimmers are very interesting birds. They skim the water for fish. They display a broken wing when you come near their nest or their chicks. So that's their defense mechanism, and they also dive at you too. At Gulf Islands National Seashore, we protect these birds because they are threatened. And if we did not protect them, there would be a high risk of people stepping on their nests or the birds abandoning their nests.
Among the most majestic of the hundreds of birds that call Gulf Islands home is the osprey. Sometimes known as the seahawk, the osprey is a fish-eating bird of prey which relies on its keen sense of vision to hunt. Osprey nests are found throughout the beaches and forests of Gulf Islands National Seashore.
Anytime you can give wildlife their own little place, it makes everybody happy. Because they need their space. They don't need to identify with humans. We walked around and there was mockingbirds in the structure of the park, and they come around and they talk to you, and then they hop into the sticker vines, which you couldn't penetrate, but if you look inside the vines, you'll see trumpet flowers, and trumpet flowers are hummingbirds. And it's great that animals and birds and mammals can use these grounds for places of refuge.
Perdido Key, which is Spanish for Lost Island, is an area that hosts many different habitats. Salt marshes, beaches with dunes, and maritime forests with pine and cedar trees. The area is abundant with wetlands, estuaries, and wildlife. In the nearby forests, a variety of mammals and reptiles make their homes among the live oaks, pines, and magnolias. Located on the Mississippi mainland, Davis Bayou is designated as a park area of Gulf Islands National Seashore, consisting of 400 acres of salt marsh, bayous, and maritime forest. The estuaries contain fresh water from streams and salt water from the tides of the Gulf of Mexico. Home to a variety of plants and animals, Davis Bayou is also a popular destination for recreational opportunities such as fishing and kayaking. In 1971, Congress set aside Horn, Pettyboy, and Ship Islands in Mississippi to be included within the boundaries of Gulf Islands National Seashore. In 1978, Horn and Pettyboy Islands were designated as wilderness areas, protecting two of the last undisturbed barrier islands still remaining along the Gulf of Mexico. And in the year 2000, the seashore's boundaries were enlarged by 2,000 acres to include portions of Cat Island. These islands are located nearly 11 miles from the mainland. The barrier islands shift and change with the effects of storms, sometimes resulting in the islands being drastically altered, such as Ship Island. Hurricane Camille split the island in half in 1969, resulting in the barrier islands known today as West Ship Island and East Ship Island. Westward currents naturally erode the islands on their east shorelines and deposit sand on the west. As time goes by, the islands migrate gradually westward.
Ship Island has been strategic throughout history for European powers as well as the early United States years. The French discovered the islands and were the first ones to talk about the harbor that it offered. In fact, they named this place Ship Island because of the harbor.
For over 80 years, the Skrmetta family has been ferrying passengers from the mainland to visit Ship Island.
My grandfather started the Ship Island excursion business in 1926 as a sideline to his shrimp and oyster business. The island is important in history because of its natural deep water port. The French were trying to establish a base in the New World, in the Louisiana Territory, and they were looking for the mouth of the Mississippi River. And they tried to go into Pensacola. They weren't allowed to go into Pensacola because of the Spanish. They moved west and they found that they had problems going into Mobile because of the British. They kept moving west and they found a deep water access into the Mississippi Sound just west of Ship Island. Later on, the British used the same charts that the French used, came into Ship Island and anchored 60 warships in front of Ship Island just prior to the attack on New Orleans in January of 1815. Because of the British attack on New Orleans, later the federal government decided to build a series of coastal fortifications beginning on the east coast near D.C. all the way around to Louisiana to here to Ship Island, which was one of the last forts built. It started in 1858.
On West Ship sits Fort Massachusetts, approved as the last brick fortification built on the Gulf Coast. Fort Massachusetts has been occupied by secessionists, Confederate and Union troops, as well as the 2nd Regiment of the Louisiana Native Guards, one of the first black regiments in the United States Army.
We actually have three different kinds of brick here at Fort Massachusetts. Two are historic and one is more in the last few decades. The buff colored brick, or sort of beige color, is made in Louisiana, and which is not too far from here, and the red brick is from Maine. 2 years into the fort being built, the Civil War breaks out. Well, Louisiana is on the southern side, and the United States Army Corps of Engineers cannot buy bricks from the southern side. So they begin to import brick from Maine, and it costs four times what the Louisiana brick costs. So all the brick you see in this fort is during the Civil War. All the buff-colored brick is before and after the Civil War. So we see three phases of building.
This is one of the last undeveloped barrier islands in the northern Gulf of Mexico. And the fact that the National Park Service protects it and keeps a mile of protection zone around it, that ensures the protected habitat of the Atlantic bottlenose dolphin, our birds such as the osprey, pelicans, shorebirds, terns. But you have miles of quiet beach to enjoy, and just to leave the automobiles and all the stress of the mainland behind, that's probably the most important thing about the island.
More than 80% of the area designated as Gulf Islands National Seashore is submerged underwater.
Altogether, the National Seashore encompasses almost 140,000 acres. And then we extend a mile out into the Gulf of Mexico and out to the Ship's Channel here in the bay. A lot of people don't see that part of the park. That's one reason we offer programs such as snorkeling here in the summer to introduce them to the underwater environment at Gulf Islands.
Gulf Islands National Seashore's barrier islands and emerald waters offer a variety of recreational opportunities. Developed campgrounds and primitive island camping are among the popular features of the park. The Florida National Scenic Trail begins at Fort Pickens, with over 28 miles of the trail crossing Gulf Islands National Seashore.
And one of the plants we have right here in front of me is called Yaupon holly. It is native to the area. It's one of our native hollies. It doesn't look like your typical holly bush, but it does get the red berries at Christmas time. These little muscadine grapes grow, creeping up on other plants. And you can see the fruit, which will be ripe in about July. Wildlife loves the muscadine grapes, so do people. This one on the other side of the trail here is called the wax myrtle, Myrica cerifera. This one has some history behind it. It produces a quantity of gray berries along the stem in the fall, and the early settlers would collect the gray berries and boil those in water. After the water cooled, you'd scrape this layer of wax that formed off the surface and use that to make a candle. And they had a pleasant scent. Like another name for this is the southern bayberry. Here on the trunk of the Yaupon holly, you can see the orange blaze that was put there by the Florida National Scenic Trail Association. And the orange blaze marks the Florida National Scenic Trail, which begins here and ends down in the Everglades, 1,300 miles to the south.
Mom, there's a fish!
Park rangers at Gulf Islands lead summer programs such as snorkeling and seining for visitors of all ages, as well as activities for children, including the Sea Star and Junior Ranger programs.
Junior Ranger programs are truly a tradition of the National Park Service. They grab a handbook in the visitor centers and they go through the park and they learn natural and cultural and just recreation things that they can do in the park. But after they finish, they are sworn in as a junior ranger.
Today we seined with the children. It is our, I think, the ranger's favorite program simply because we introduce them to the underwater world. You cannot go wrong with children in water, but once they see what is below the water and they scoop up the fish or the shrimp or the hermit crabs, we're able to explain that there's more than just terrestrial life. There's marine life that begins the beginning of the food chain.
One time we saw a white one and it was hairy and it is so feisty.
Really?
It was so feisty.
That's what seining is. We pull a seine net to show the children not only a skill of a lifetime, but to pull creatures they normally would not see.
Okay, y'all ready? Let's get that pipe fish in here. Y'all want to see a shrimp?
And afterwards, we talk about them. We talk about how they live in the water and how they hide and camouflage themselves. And we also talk about how things are hurting them, like trash and fishing line. And children are so receptive. I mean, they're the most wonderful audience.
We're doing catch and release, where we would catch them, look at them, observe them, and just look at them for a little bit, and then we release them.
Does everybody know what this map is? Everybody say it out loud.
The United States of America.
Yes, a map of the United States of America. And we are right here in Florida.
Basically, with the Park Service, there's rangers, and there's this class called Junior Ranger, where they teach you how to be rangers and everything that they do. And they teach you about all the animals and how to protect it, and we do games. It's a really good program.
Everybody look over this direction. Y'all see that water out there? That's the sound. You see the darkness? That's where all the animals live. Anybody love seafood?
I've learned a lot because I've been here for a while. So we've learned a lot about plants, the sea, and the reptiles, the animals, mammals, a lot of really cool things that live here.
I.
As
a junior ranger.
As a junior ranger.
To me, the junior rangers are truly one of my favorite group of people coming into the park. I love all the visitors. They all teach me something. But for junior rangers, they're such a group of young people with young minds, open hearts, and they're just ready to go. They're ready to learn. I want children to realize that the natural world is the most wonderful, peaceful, beautiful place to be. This is a place where, when things are hard at school, when things don't make sense in their little world, or when things are unusual or unsettling, that just to step outside in the natural world balances them. That's what I like to do, is to show children you don't have to be afraid.
We've got a beautiful night. We'll have Jupiter rising probably around 9 o'clock, but before that we'll also have the Milky Way, just gorgeous, running all across the sky from the south to the north.
This is the Escambia Amateur Astronomy Association, and they've been with the National Park Service for about 33 years, donating their time and their telescopes to opening people's eyes and knowledge about the dark skies in national parks.
Out here, the skies are so much darker, especially facing the south. You just can't see things in town that you can see out here.
I believe it educates people on the environment and how to take care of the environment, which works hand in hand with the Astronomy Club, because light pollution is a big factor in things that we're trying to control. People don't realize that the light and the amount of wattage they put out is significantly more than they need. And then we like to show people what they're losing running all the lights in town the way they do.
What it does is it brings out youngsters and adults and people from all over the country to take a look at the big telescopes. It opens their eyes to a whole nother universe.
Telescopes like Gary's will show you new star clusters emerging from nebulae. We'll show old stars doing stellar stripteases, like the Ring Nebula in Lyra, where a giant star has sloughed off its outer layers.
They are gracious enough to allow us to look through the telescopes, and previously you get to see the rings of Saturn as well as Jupiter, the moons. Quite spectacular to see it all. And then every once in a while somebody will show part of the moon, and it's the detail that, you know, you obviously just can't see with the naked eye.
I especially like it, young kids, when they'll come up to you and you'll show them something. I have binoculars, and I'll show them something through the binoculars, and you know that, oh, wow, cool. They're just so enthralled by that. And then you can tell them some of the few little things that I know, and they just absorb everything. And it's so neat to know that you may be, you know, this could be an astronaut.
See that red star? That is Antares, or Antares for short. It is the rival of Mars for good reason. Right now, it's about the same brightness and the same orange-red color as the planet Mars, which you'll notice is not out in the August evening sky. It rises about 4 o'clock in the morning.
It's wonderful to come out here to Gulf Islands. Just the history of the place, the skies, it's just a beautiful place to come.
Hurricanes have wreaked havoc on the barrier islands and coastal shore areas of Gulf Islands. The road to Fort Pickens and the road connecting Gulf Islands from Pensacola to Navarre were washed away by Hurricanes Ivan in 2004 and Dennis in 2005. Natural landscapes also suffered from the storms, with thousands of trees destroyed. The number of visitors was also greatly affected. Before the hurricane damage, each year nearly 5 million visitors enjoyed the history, natural beauty, and recreational opportunities found at Gulf Islands.
All right, one, two, three, go.
Yay! Yay! All right.
But in early 2009, the roads were reopened and Fort Pickens became more easily accessible.
This means a lot to Pensacola Beach and the Santa Rosa Island Authority to have the road to Fort Pickens open. It couldn't have happened without Congressman Jeff Miller helping us. We went over there and met, and it was Earl Bowden and Grover Robinson and myself and some other folks with the National Park Service, Jerry. How important this road is, not only for the National Park Service, but for our local residents who enjoy to come out and camp out here as well as the tourists that want to come here. And I can't tell you how many calls have been received, whether it's the Visitors Information Center or the Santa Rosa Island Authority office, over the last 2 years. When is that road going to be open? Well, last Friday, it opened.
Hi, you're the Florida Trail Association. Yeah. They've already signed in here. I'll just add another tally mark for you. And the trash bags are right over here.
Each year, residents and visitors are encouraged to come to Gulf Islands to participate in the International Coastal Cleanup.
We've invited the public out to help clean up. We've got different groups from the university campuses to high schools, Boy Scouts and Girl Scouts, Boys Clubs, high school clubs. They're out here helping out. People who are our park neighbors are coming out to help clean up these beaches.
Well, we're with the Boys and Girls Club of Escambia County, and this is our teen group called the Crunk Keystone. And we're here because we get invited to come out here every year and clean up the beach. Throughout the years, trash accumulates, and our kids, we knew, and now it's time to teach the younger kids. That's very important to keep it clean, because this is a beautiful area. People come here on vacation, and it's important to make sure that we keep it clean.
We're finding all kinds of different trash, a lot of plastics, a lot of bottles, wood from old boardwalks, things that are in people's houses that may have been washed out from Hurricane Ivan several years ago that are still washing up on the beach today. Cigarette butts, plastic bags, food things, just a lot of different kinds of debris.
Nearly 450 years after the arrival of DeLuna, the city of Pensacola celebrated the rich history of the area, beginning with the settlement of Pensacola in 1559 by Spanish explorers.
Ladies and gentlemen, their majesties, the King and Queen of Spain.
Spain's royal couple, King Juan Carlos and Queen Sofia, traveled to Pensacola to be part of this historic celebration.
Thank you again for your efforts in preserving our common heritage, for commemorating your town's important place in the history of North America, and for your willingness to keep working together with Spain for a better future. Viva Pensacola! Long live Pensacola! Thank you very much.
The world's third largest tall ship, the Juan Sebastian de Elcano, sailed from Spain to Pensacola through the waters of Gulf Islands National Seashore in observance of the anniversary, representing the journey of DeLuna and honoring the community's Spanish heritage.
It's always wonderful to see sailing vessels come into the bay, because when you see a sailing ship, particularly one like the Elcano, those four masts coming by Old Fort Pickens and by Fort Barrancas, it really takes you back to the time of the original forts. It gives you a really nice visual image of what these forts were built for, because these things were built in the days of wooden sailing vessels and cast iron cannons, when a solid brick wall was good enough to defend the country.
It's just an amazing place, ladies and gentlemen, and one of the great things about it is that it belongs to you. This is public land. This is part of the national park system. And the idea is to enjoy these places today, but to do it in a way that's going to preserve them, so that when these kids grow up and they have kids and they grow up and they have kids and they grow up, they can still come out on a beautiful summer's day, learn something about the history of the country.
It is a very long-term way of thinking in a country that tends to be somewhat short-term in our goals oftentimes. So the National Park Service and the National Park System is in many ways one of the grandest ideas we've come up with in this country. And I don't just say that because I work for you guys and for the National Park Service, but because I really believe it.
All of us as park rangers, we all are signed up, you know, as park rangers. We get the uniform, we get the badge, we get the hat. But as you enter into the service, then you start, you have a passion, first off. It may be history, it may be natural history. But then you start meeting the American people, and you start seeing their needs, and you start seeing their passion.
Gulf Islands National Seashore, along with the National Park Service, they are integral,
crucial into protecting our nation's historical treasures. If it weren't for the National Park Service, we wouldn't be able to come here to enjoy these historic forts and to really gain something from the meaning, from the history and experience of mankind that they've left behind. Thousands of people come here to enjoy the history and to make a connection with our past, and these forts are a great way to do that, to really get the most out of our national treasures.
Visitors who stroll down the seashore experience the rhythmic waves, the unspoiled beaches, the peace, tranquility, and serenity. They walk on grounds that trace America's earliest origins. They follow in the footsteps of Native Americans, European explorers, and colonial Americans.
People have a connection to their past. We are all connected, and we find a need to make that connection to our past and to our history. And what the National Park does is it allows for that connection. It allows for you to see your forefathers out at Fort Pickens or over at Fort Barrancas, or what the prehistoric Indians did here 5,000 years ago. You just feel that connection when you go into any national park.
This park is just a diverse collection of nature and bird life and sea life, beach life, and man's intrusion by weapons of war that are obsolete, but still telling about the early part of America, the making of America, is protected forever for the American people.
People come out here, you know, and they're like, they're changed. They're just not, they didn't realize they could come someplace like this.
This is an area or areas that our country has decided are important enough for us to set aside, not just for this generation, but for future generations to come out and enjoy. So I often consider the parks kind of America's playground, a place to come out and enjoy yourself, keeping in mind that you're not the last one to use it and leaving it like it was when you got here for the people that come next. Of course, it's nice to have an agency like the Park Service that has a federal mandate. It's called the Organic Act. It's kind of like our theme statement, and it basically tells us what to do, and that is that we will preserve and protect the natural and the historic objects and the wildlife therein, and it states not just for us, but for the enjoyment of future generations.
The park rangers, staff, and volunteers are able to take people back in time and just something different that you don't find every day in the city. It's something wild and remote. It's beyond words, really.
Gulf Islands National Seashore. It's a fairly unusual little area. It's kind of like a string of jewels along the central Gulf Coast. We've got 12 different areas, half of them in Florida, half of them in Mississippi. We have barrier islands, we have some mainland units, we've got outstanding natural areas, we have some outstanding historic sites, and we have some of the prettiest beaches in the world. I like to tell people we've got a little bit of everything that you find anywhere in the national park system. We've got great natural features, great historical features, and great recreational opportunities. So what more do you need? It's all right here. It's really pretty special. It's why I've been able to stay here so long and be so happy with it.
It's just a great piece of America. Brick forts that were built in the early part of the 19th century that are preserved so generations of Americans can see them and see what once protected America and learn from it.
It belongs to the American people. One of the great things about this is that this is a national treasure in its most pure sense. This belongs to all the people in the country, and we are preserving it for the people in this country and all the people in the world. The gifts that America has and has made are things that we think are worth preserving, and not just locking away in a vault, but preserving in a way that exhibits them, that shows them off, but to do it carefully and with respect.
If you stop people long enough, off the highway, off their beaten track of life, to just stop momentarily and listen and smell and feel, that is the magic of the national park, and it's their national park.
Some of those people who opposed that park in those days have told me that it's the best thing we ever did. There's something about a national park, when you're there, you feel like you own it, and you do. One of the best ideas we ever had in America.
Gulf Island's National Seashore is a masterpiece of nature, a witness to history, the treasure of the Gulf Coast.
Support for this documentary was provided by Innisfree Hotels, home to vacation destinations at Pensacola Beach, Perdido Key, and Orange Beach. Innisfree Hotels is proud to provide hospitality to those who visit Gulf Island's National Seashore and pleased to showcase the natural beauty, rich history, and recreational opportunities of the Gulf Coast. To obtain a copy of this program, call 1-800-239-9773 or visit WSRE.org. Also available, a print of an original watercolor painting of Gulf Island's National Seashore by acclaimed artist Nina Fritz.